Hello everyone, this is Dr. Ashish Manmai and welcome to the third part of the video lecture of Chapter 6, Morphological Image Processing. So far in the previous two video lectures, we have seen basic morphological operations like erosion, dilation, opening and closing. Now we move to the fifth operation, that is called as hit and miss transform. Hit and miss transform actually a tool to detect shapes in an image. The formulation of hit and miss transform is something like this. We consider A as a set in which we want to find the location of object X. And we consider B as set composed of X and its background W. And then we formulate the hit and miss transform, that is A hit and miss transform with B as A erode X intersection with A complement erode W minus X. The symbol of hit and miss transform is an asterisk sign with a circle around it. So it is something like a symbol of a circular convolution. To understand the hit and miss transform, let's consider this example. So here we have image A, which is made up of three components X, Y and Z. So X is a square component as shown in the figure. Z is also a square component, whereas Y is a rectangular component. And if you see the sizes, then you will find that the size of Z is less than the size of the component X. Whereas the component Y is having a width greater than X and the height is much larger than its width. Now to identify this component X from this image A, we first create a window. So window will be of a slightly greater size than that of X. Okay, and that is shown in the second figure over here. And then we find out W minus X. Now in all these images what we have shown, okay, the gray portions actually indicate value 1 and the white portions actually indicate value 0. Now to process this, we will require A complement. So first we find the A complement, which is shown in third image over here. So wherever we have 1, it will become 0, and wherever we have 0, it will become 1. So in the hit and miss transform, the first step is to find A erode with X. So we take the component X and we erode the image A. Now as we have already seen, the X component, when we try to erode it, it will be contained only when we keep the center of X aligned with the center of X. Okay, and if we move the center away from it, then X will not be contained by X itself. Hence, it will generate only a single point. Z is of a smaller size of X. Hence, it cannot contain X. Hence, when we erode that particular component, it will totally vanish. Whereas Y component has a width as well as height greater than X. Hence, when we erode it, in the center, it will create some output. So that is what is shown in the fourth figure over here. So there is a dot corresponding to X. Okay, there is a small rectangle corresponding to Y component and the Z vanishes totally. So this is the output of the first step, that is A erode with X. In the second step, we take W minus X and we erode A complement. So when we do this, since the W minus X is actually the boundary around component X, okay, again, it will fit exactly around the component X and it will create a single point. Whereas when you consider the component Y in A complement, that particular window will never fit. Hence, that component will totally get vanished when we perform A complement eroded with W minus X. For the Z component, which is of smaller size of X, this window will again fit, okay, at certain position and it will create some output, which is shown in the top figure over here. Okay, so when we have done this second operation, again there is a point corresponding to X that is created, but this time Y has totally vanished. Whereas there is some output corresponding to a component which is of smaller size, that is Z. So you can see that in the figure over here at the top. And the last step is to find the intersection of whatever the first erode result, that is A eroded with X, and the second erosion result, that is A complement eroded with W minus X. So when we find this intersection, there is only a common point corresponding to X that will be left out. And that is how we identify the location of component X in A. In general, we have the formulation of Hit-and-miss transform something like this. We consider A as a set in which we want to identify the location of object X. And B will be composed of two components now. One, that is B1, which is the object that we want to identify. And B2 will be the background. Hence, the formulation of hit and miss transform will be A erode with B1 intersection with A complement erode with B2. And we can write the same thing as A erode with B1 intersection with A dilation with B2 cap. And this is the very commonly used formulation when we deal with hit and miss transform. Now we have understood the basic operations that we perform in morphology, that is dilation, erosion, opening, closing, and hit and miss transform. Now let's move towards the application. So let's see some basic morphological algorithms or application that we have. One of the simplest application or the algorithms in morphology is boundary extraction. And the formulation is very simple. The boundary of an object A is denoted as beta A, and it is given by A minus A erode with B. So first find what is A erode with B and subtract that result from the A, and what you will get is the boundary of A. So look at this example. So we have a component A over here given, and there is a 3 cross 3 all one structuring element B that is normally used for boundary extraction. So when you erode A with B, obviously A component will shrink by 1 pixel from each side because we are considering the structuring element B that is of size 3 cross 3. So if you consider the center or the origin, then on the top there is one row, at the bottom there is one row, on the left there is one column, and on the right there is one column of center of B. Hence, the erosion result will shrink the object A by 1 pixel. And that is what is shown in the third figure over here. And to extract the boundary, we are simply going to subtract A minus A erode B. So when you perform this subtraction, okay, what you get is a boundary that is shown in figure 4 over here. This is the example of boundary extraction of a binary image. So there is a binary image of a person over there, and when you apply this algorithm, it will extract that boundary of a person, which is shown in the second figure. The second very commonly used morphological algorithm is region filling. Now this algorithm is very important when we want to extract some components of an image, but because of some errors or because of the noise, when we extract the component, we get some holes in the object or the component. So this algorithm will be used to fill such holes or hollow regions. This is actually a recursive algorithm that we use. So in this case, we have xk as xk minus 1 dilated with b, and then we take the intersection with a complement where k will have 1, 2, 3 values, etc. And here x0 is a point inside the boundary to be filled, and the algorithm will perform iteratively. So every time when you start, so you will first start with x0, you will dilate it with b, and then you will take the intersection with a complement. So that will become your x1. Then you apply the recursion formula on x1, so you will have x1 dilation with b, and then you take the intersection with a complement, that will become your x2, and you keep on doing this process, and the process will ultimately terminate when there is no change. That means your xk will be same as xk minus 1. Now once the algorithm has terminated, we find the final filled image, that is a filled as a union with xk. Let's consider the example of region filling over here. So in this case, the first image shows the component A, and you can see that there is a hollow region inside the boundary of A, and we want to fill it. So in this process, we are going to require the A complement. So A complement is already found and shown in figure 2. Now for filling this region, we use a component that is shown in figure 3, that is our structuring element B. If you see, it's a 3 cross 3 structuring element with a center element as 1 and 4 neighbors are 1, whereas the diagonal neighbors are 0 over here. So it is something like a plus structuring element that we are using over here. Just remember one thing in these examples, whatever we are discussing, we are representing the gray as white or 1, and the white regions are actually black with the value 0. Okay, so this is the notation that we are going to use throughout. Now first we want to select the starting point, that is our x0, and this x0 has to be inside the region that we want to fill. So you can see over here what is our A. So we select a point where we are going to start, and that is shown in the second figure over here, and this becomes our x0, and on this x0 we are now going to perform recursive operation. To find x1, we are first going to dilate x0 with B, and whatever the result, we are then going to take the intersection with A complement. So we'll start with x0 over here, and this is our structuring element B. Now there is a very beautiful thing that about this structuring element B. Now this B has a plus kind of shape, or you can say the center element and the four neighbors are 1 over here, and the diagonal neighbors are 0. Because of this structure, when you perform the operation of dilation, every time when you perform the operation of dilation, whatever the component that we have, it is going to expand, and it is going to expand only along the four directions. That means it can expand at the top, bottom, left and right. Now since the diagonal element are 0 in the structuring element, it will not expand diagonally. So when we perform the dilation of x0 with B, you can see the result in the third image, where that single point now has expanded in all the four directions, and that becomes the x0 dilation with B. Now whatever the result we obtained after dilation, we are going to take its intersection with A complement. So here if you see the third figure, that is what the intersection will be, and this will become our x1. So if you observe carefully what has happened over here, the A complement actually prevents the dilation result to go outside the boundary of A. If you see the result of x0 dilated with B, okay, there are two points, that is on the left hand side and the top side after the expansion, actually has gone outside the boundary of A. When we take the intersection, these two points are actually removed. So the main role of the A complement will be always to prevent the result of the dilation to go outside the boundary of A. And this is going to happen every time we take the intersection. Now whatever x1 we have obtained, again we are going to dilate it with B, and then whatever result we get, again we are going to take the intersection with A complement. So here you can see what is x1 and the result that we will obtain after performing its dilation with B. Now whatever result after dilation, we are again going to take the intersection with A complement. So here we will have x1 dilated with B and then intersection with A complement, and that will give us x2. And you can again see that this intersection operation has prevented the dilation to go outside the boundary of A. So here we have obtained our x2. Again we can process like this, and we can find out x3, x4, and we can continue this process recursively till there is no change in x. That means my xk becomes same as my previous xk minus 1. So at that point we will stop. In this particular slide, you can see the results at a glance. So first image is as we started with A, then we have A complement, the structuring element B. In the second row, the first is our starting point x0, then what we got as x1, x2, And then if we continue, we'll have x3, x4, x5, etc. The x6 is shown over here in the third row, first figure. Then we have x7. And when we continue after x7, actually the value of x or the elements of x doesn't change. Okay, so we will terminate our algorithm at that point of time. And then we will find the intersection of A with x7 or x8. And the final result what you will get is your field image, and that is what is shown in this third row last image. And that is how you can get your A field completely. Now you can observe over here, we have taken a starting point x0, and based on that the filling algorithm has taken certain steps or certain iterations you can say, and my A got filled. So here the starting point will actually play a very critical role. If you choose a starting point normally at the center of the object, that is what you want to fill, then your recursions will be less. If you select one of the corners, then there will be more recursion that you will require. Here is an example on actual binary images. So in the first image you can see the region that we want to fill, and over there you can see if you see a big circle over there, inside there is a white dot, so that becomes our starting point. And when you perform this algorithm, you can see that circle gets filled. Now what we can do is, at the same point we can select the starting points in different circles which we want to fill over here, and as we process, okay, automatically all the circles will get filled, and that is what you can see in the third image over here. The next algorithm that is commonly used is a thinning algorithm. Many times the object can be thick, and when we want to extract some information, we want to thin them before we actually extract some information. So in such cases, we use this thinning algorithm. The symbol for thinning is a cross with a circle around it, and it is given as A minus A hit and miss transform with B. Or you can also write the thinning operation as A intersection of A hit and miss transform with B the whole complement. Okay, in general what we have B as a set of different structure elements B1, B2, B3, so on up to Bn, where Bi is a rotated version of Bi minus 1. And in that case the thinning operation, that is A thin with set B, is given as A first thin with B1, this whatever result is then thin with B2, and so on, and then thin with Bn. Let's consider the example of thinning over here. So look at this figure. In the top you can see 8 different structuring elements B1, B2, B3, so on up to B8. If you observe these structuring elements, you'll find that each structuring element is a 45 degree rotative version of the previous structuring element, and there is a object A that we want to thin. Okay, so that is shown in the second row of the image over here. In the same second row you can see the result of A thin with B1. So it is a individual result when you thin A only with B1, and here you can see that when you do this operation, your object has thinned in a particular direction. Okay, similarly you can see the third figure of the second row, where it is a result of A thin with B2. Again you can observe that it has thinned the object A in a particular direction. Similarly you can see the result of A thin with B3, or thin with B4 or B5, B6, B7, B8, etc. Now in all these cases you can see that whenever you perform the thinning operation, the thinning will do only in a particular direction. So what we do now, we apply this algorithm recursively as explained in the previous slide. So we first thin with B1, whatever result we will then thin with B2, whatever result we will then thin with B3, so on up to B8, and it will thin every time in each direction depending on your structuring element. So in the fourth row last column you can see the result after thinning after 1, 2 and 3rd, and in the bottom row you can see the result where we have thinned by the remaining elements. After the convergence, we apply the M connectivity to remove the unwanted pixels in the thinned image. So you can see the final result over here, which is a thin version of the element or the object A that we had. The fourth commonly used morphological algorithm is thickening. Thickening is denoted by a dot with a circle around it, and it is given as A union of A hit and miss transform with B. So over here it is kind of a opposite of what we have done in the thinning. So in general, again, we can consider B made up of different structuring elements like B1, B2, so on up to Bn, where Bi will be again a rotated version of Bi minus 1. And then when we thicken A with this set B, okay, we can do it as a recursion. That means we can first thicken A with B1, whatever the result, then we can thicken with B2, and we can continue this process, and at the end we will thicken the result with Bn. Normally, for simplifying the operation or to implement it in a quick succession, what we can do is we form a C as A complement. We first thin C and then we form C complement to get the thickened result. So to understand, let's consider this example of thickening. Here the first image shows the set A or the component A that we want to thicken. The second figure is the complement of A. So whatever is this A complement, we apply the thinning algorithm on it, and the result of thinning is shown in the third image. We then take its complement, which is shown over here in the fourth image. So actually this is a thickening version of A, but you can see some disconnected components in this fourth image. So what we do is we remove these disconnected components, and then whatever result we get is our final thickened component of A. So in this video we saw four basic morphological algorithms, that is boundary extraction, region filling, thinning and thickening. However, there are many other algorithms also. So like you can study skeletons, extraction of connected component, convex hulls, or operation of pruning. So students are advised to refer any standard textbook and or any other literature that is available to them and study more about these morphological algorithms. So this brings us to the end of this chapter of morphological image processing. If you have any doubts, then please write back to me at my email ID ivpashish@gmail.com. Thank you.